All right.
So yeah, James is going to talk to you about Elixir and Redux and all things.
All full stack talk.
Full stack.
Yeah.
So, take it away.
Hi. My name is James Smith. A little bit about me. I work at Gaslight, and I like to play the banjo while wearing silly hats and take wizard selfies. So as I said, this is a full stack talk. This is the stack I've been playing with recently and really enjoying, and I find myself going to more and more for personal projects. And I just wanted to share a little bit about that. I promise I won't go too far into Elixir and Phoenix, since this is a JavaScript meetup, but non-JavaScript trigger warning here. A little bit about Elixir. Elixir is a server-side language. It started in 2012 by Jose Villeme, and it was his attempt to write a language that solved some of the issues that he was experiencing with Ruby while he was maintaining Rails. It's built on top of the Beam virtual machine, which is the virtual machine that powers Erlang. A little quick history about Erlang. It's a language originally developed by Joe Armstrong, Robert Verding, and Mike Williams at Ericsson back in 1986. So it is not a new language. It was designed to handle the needs of phone switches at the time and systems that needed large amounts of concurrency, uptime, and high availability. It powers around 50% of the world's mobile data and is used by companies such as WhatsApp to handle millions of concurrent connections from, I think they just hit 1 billion users. So, Elixir is a functional language. I don't want to go too far depth here, but it has most of the things you would expect from a functional language. It has first-class functions that you would expect. You can pass functions to functions. It supports higher-order functions. So here we have a doubler. We're passing the function that takes a single parameter, multiplies that by 2, and we're passing that to map over a range of 1 to 10, and we'll double our numbers. It also, being a functional language, supports immutability. So at the top here, I have a laser pointer, so I'm totally going to use it. We have a list of 1, 2, and 3, and we define a variable k. We delete the second position there, and now we can see K is a list of 1 and 3, but L isn't altered at all. It's immutable. Similar here, A equals foo, B equals A equals baz, B is foo still, A is baz. Another common thing you'll find in functional languages is heavy use of recursion and tail recursion. So here we're going to define a module called final. We have two functions called countdown. You might notice that, hey, wait, those are the same function. You're right, sort of. At compile time, this will compile down to one function with two separate heads, one that matches on an empty list, and one that matches a head-tail split. So this is the syntax for splitting head and tail in Elixir. So we call final countdown with 1 through 10, and we get, it's the final countdown. So recursion is a way, is heavily used to accomplish things in Elixir. It also uses recursion. But the main difference, I think, in Elixir and Erlang than some other languages you've used is that it has a language construct built in called processes. And these aren't the kind of processes you would think of as operating system processes, where you have a fairly high amount of overhead. You know, operating system processes, you know, you might be able to get 10,000 on a box, but you're really pushing it, right? These are lightweight concurrent processes that are as small as 5K. I think they're actually smaller than that, but. So here we're gonna spawn a process that is a function that adds 1 and 2. That gives us back a PID, which is a process identifier. And we're gonna ask if that process is alive, and it's not, because it's done. It's already done its work, right? Self is a shortcut for asking what my process is. So we're in the REPL here. IEX is the REPL for Elixir. And self refers to our own PID. So everything is a process just about in Elixir. We ask if we're alive. That's true, which is good. Beats the alternative. Here we're assigning parent to ourself. We're spawning a function, and then we're having that function send a message. Message passing is another heavily used pattern in Elixir. We'll have this process, this function, send a message back to us with greeting, sensing, you change that to JS. Last time I gave this talk was at Sensi Functional Programming. And we get back a PID. Then we're going to try and receive that message. So each process has a mailbox. It is a first in, first out queue. And receive is how you pull something out of your mailbox. And it's going to look for a message that matches this pattern. In this case, hello, got hello from our PID, and we'll see that we got it. I promise this will be relevant to some of the JavaScript stuff I'm going to get to. So with these, all of these patterns, you build things that often look like this, where we have a stateful server process. So this is the a really simple implementation of a stack. And you can see that we're spawning a process that takes an empty list. And this is our loop function where we're going to recurse, right? And we have a couple methods that are functions that we can push and pop things off of the stack, right? So when we receive a pop, we'll take the product in the state and we'll pop it off the list and then send it back, the product back to the caller. And then we'll recurse. So push, we're just going to loop, and then we're going to push the value onto the head of the list. So that's the head-tail split syntax I talked about earlier. We'll start our stack, get the PID. We're going to send it a pop message. We get an empty list. We push 1, 2, and 3. We pop 3 times. We get 3, 2, 1. So you see this kind of pattern a lot. In fact, there's higher level abstractions for doing the same exact thing. This is called Gen Server. It's a part of the OTP framework that ships with Elixir and Erlang. So this is a higher level abstraction for doing the same thing. Really, all that's happening is we have a stateful service or a process that takes a message, receives the current state, produces the next state. And you'll see this again later. So a little bit about Phoenix. That's the my backend web framework I'm using. It's a MVC web framework written by Chris. Oh, that was too fast. Written by Chris McCord, who is from Dayton, so local. That's awesome. It's being used by a lot of companies right now, and it's growing in popularity. Bleacher Report's using it. Pro Football Focus, Pinterest, is using it to heavy success. And it's currently in version 1.2 and being used in production. The thing to know about it is that it's not Rails. It's a lot different than Rails. It is an MVC web framework, but being built on top of Elixir and Erlang provides it a lot of features that Rails has trouble supporting, like lots of concurrent processes and connections. It's not unheard of to handle a million processes or a million connections on a single machine. This is something that would be pretty difficult to do in Rails. So that's what I'm using for my back end. On the front end, though, which is a little more relevant to us, I've been using React for a little bit now and really enjoying my time with it. I think it's a really simple abstraction that takes a little bit to get used to. It's just a view library, right? It allows you to build components, pass data down to those components, and do things with it. Some of the different things about it is that it has a virtual DOM. So because of that, templates are a little different than what you might be used to. You actually create your JavaScript templates in your JavaScript, which we'll see here in a little bit. It throws some people off for a while. It takes a little bit of getting used to. But now I've been using it for a while. It's not so bad. The nice thing about it is it supports a really easy data flow, where data flows in one direction. Data flows down through your components. Your components do things. They bubble up actions, and that gets handled higher up the stack. This is Ember also has this concept, data down, actions up, if you've heard that. It's component oriented, which makes breaking your UI into smaller components really nice. But one of the things I did notice after playing with it for a little while is you start to have logic spread about your application to manage state. And it kind of filters everywhere. So I was looking for a way to deal with that. And that's when I found Redux. Redux is a library for any language, actually. It's written in Java or any framework, JavaScript framework. Its main idea is that state should be stored in a single state tree. That state tree should be immutable. And it should be the only way to interact with it will be pure functions. It's written by Dan Abramov. It was heavily influenced by the Flux architecture and Elm, actually, which if you were at CincyFP last night, you heard a little bit about. Elm is super exciting, but I'm holding off a little bit because I can only learn so many new things. There are three principles to Redux. Once you understand these three principles, it kind of makes the framework make a lot more sense. And you'll see that out of these three design decisions, a really elegant solution is formed. The first principle of Redux is that the state of your whole application is stored in an object tree called a store. Here we have our state, we have some characters, we have a round number, a turn number, and here are the characters as a list of characters. We have some combatants and some NPCs. Anybody that knows me might see where this is going. The second principle of Redux is that state is read-only. The only way to mutate state is to emit an action, to emit an action, which is an object describing what happened. So that's the second principle. The third principle of Redux is that changes must be made with pure functions. I'm sorry, I think I skipped over that last piece. I forgot I added code to the slide. So these are actions. They're just functions that return an object with a type that describes what the action is. And then it's passed some data. This is data that it needs to do something to transform the state, which we'll talk about in a second. So here we have an add combatant. It returns an action of add combatant with a single combatant. Remove combatant, returns a combatant. Next turn doesn't need anything. It just takes next turn, or just returns an action of next turn. Same with end combat. Okay. The third principle is changes must be made with pure functions. So I don't know if you can read that, but this is a reducer. This is how you transform your state in your state tree. So you emit an action. The action is given to the reducer. The reducer has the initial state in the action and produces the next state. So here we have add combatant, and we object assign here, so we don't want to mutate state, all right? Because it's a pure function, right? Combatants plus combatant, so we have the combatant that's added. We use a spread operator in ES6 to pull apart those combatants and add our combatant to it. And then we return the previous state plus our combatant. In combat basically clears the state tree, and you always want to make sure that you have a default state that just returns the current state. That way, crashes are less. If there's an unhandled action, it just defaults to that. So let's review the three principles, the three different moving pieces real quick. So actions tell you what happened in your application. Think of this as a timeline of events. It's your app's newsfeed. I added a combatant. I removed a different combatant. I started the next turn. It's a list of what has happened to the state in your application. The store, this is the current state of your application. It's a good idea when you're designing your application with Redux, it's a good idea to think about what the shape of your state is going to be before you start writing any code. What's the minimum representation of data you're going to use in your application? And I found that really helps the rest of the flow to kind of start with the store and work your way down. Reducers. Reducers tell how the state will be changed based on what happened. So you might be saying, wait, you mentioned this before, stateful servers in Elixir. This is the same pattern. We have the previous state, an action, we produce the next state. A really good quote I heard recently is, if you think you don't have a distributed system, then that's because you haven't realized your client-side application is just another node in the system. So Elixir and Erlang particularly have been solving distribution problems for 25 years. And they've come up with abstractions that help solve that problem in elegant ways by making some simple design decisions. And I don't really think that it is a coincidence that Redux, having chosen some of the similar design decisions, also has a similar effect of making handling state and asynchronous issues easier. So last review, this is the basic architecture. We have our view, which is a React view. We have an action creator. The view calls an action creator that creates an action that gets passed to the reducer, that gets passed to the store, that handles data down to the view. So I talked about the design decisions of Redux. What does it buy me? Well, one of the things that was very nice when I started using it was this idea of separating my components in React into container components versus presentational components. So what does that mean? This is a presentational component. You can see here we have our turn tracker, we pass the current turn, characters, NPCs, and then we pass some actions that we're going to call. But for the most part, this is just rendering our components. There's no logic here. Character list gets characters and the on add character action. NPC list gets NPCs, current turn gets current turn, round number. Combatant list, combatants. No logic here, just presentational code. And this is what I was talking about in React, where your template is in your code. It takes people a while to get used to this. Some people never do. That's okay. I do kind of wonder what it's like to work on an application with a designer because of this, but I haven't had that opportunity yet. Some other people here, I think, have, so might want to talk to them. So that was a presentational component. This is a container component. So we have our presentational components, and we're passing data down to them. Something has to store a reference to our store that stores our state, knows about our reducer, knows about the actions we have. And this is where you would do it. So this is my app container. It creates a store. It bundles up some middleware we're going to use, particularly by default, Redux is supports synchronous actions only. If you want to do asynchronous actions, you need to bring in some middleware. The most common supported, highly encouraged one is Thunk, which is a computer science term I wasn't aware of before this. Thunk is just basically a function that returns a subroutine that gets called. Here we're gonna wire in our dev tools, which I'll show in a little bit. But we define an app component that has a render function. We, at the beginning, we're gonna dispatch a couple actions to the store. In this case, we're gonna get all the characters and the NPCs from the server. And then we're gonna return a component that has a provider that stores a reference to the store. This provider component actually passes the store down to all of our child components. So all of our child components can subscribe to the store, can dispatch actions to the store, but we just render our main turn tracker application inside of there. So that's a component that has logic. So being able to separate those two is nice. So what else does it give us? It gives us an easier way to test the flow of state in our application. So I mentioned we have a single state tree that stores all the state in our application. We emit actions that get passed to a reducer that transforms that. And reducers are just pure functions. So what that means is we end up with some pretty easy tests. So here we're going to test a reducer. Here's our initial state. We're going to describe the initial state and make sure that it's what we expect. Then we're going to start testing our individual components. Here was this was one of the more trickier reducers actions that I wrote, so I wrote a test for it. We capture our first state, we take the turn reducer with the initial state, and then we pass the add character action with some data. And then we're adding another character, and then we're going to add an NPC. Okay, so we have Joe, Sue, and a goblin, and we're going to see what the next state should be. We're going to expect that Joe, Sue, and the goblin should be in the combatants list, and that the first one should be a goblin, because if you've ever played a tabletop RPG, initiative determines who goes first. And the goblin has a higher initiative on Joe and Sue. So Joe and Sue are in a lot of trouble now because the goblin's going to go first. So then, edge case, we have a tie in initiative. What should happen? Well, we take the first state, we add a bugbear. Bugbear, imagine an orc, but furry and larger. See, you didn't know you were going to be learning Dungeons & Dragons when you came. But if I'm giving a talk, you should expect that. That's what will happen. Anyway, it has an initiative of 10 and an agility mod of 1. The goblin also has an initiative of 10, but he's a little smaller, a little faster, right? He has an agility mod of 2. Well, we take our reducer and we pass next turn action. We should see that the goblin should be next, and that passes. So I found a nice flow of think about what state I'm going to have on the page, think about what actions I'm going to need to transform that state, and then start writing tests for my reducers. And that kind of test-driven flow just kind of fell out of it, and it was really nice to work with. So the third thing that comes out of these design decisions is time traveling debugging, which I will show here in just a second. So I'm going to do a quick demo. This is my application. Oh, you can't see that. Well, that's unfortunate. Okay. Displays. This always happens. Arrangement. Mirror displays. Okay, cool. All right. Nope. Oh, thanks. No, that's not what I wanted. Actually, please do mirror. Thank you. All right, cool. All right. So now all my windows are moved around, so let's resize them. Okay. Drag that down. Okay, so I'm using, there's a library for React called Material UI that kind of gives you some Material UI components to make your application a little easier to style. And because I'm a developer and not a designer, it made things really nice. So this is our application. And these are the development tools for Redux. You can download them. They're a Chrome extension. And let's use our application, and then I'll show you what time traveling debugging looks like. So we're going to create a combat. We're going to add Frank. Now we can see our state tree has transformed. We have some combatants. Frank. Let's go ahead and add Joe. Susan. Okay. So now let's have them square off against a couple goblins. All right. So we can see that our state tree over here is being modeled. Let me see what that looks like. We have some NPCs. We have some characters. And this is our list of current combatants. And we can see that turn and round number aren't being used yet. So let's kind of begin the combat. All right, we're on round one, turn one. Current turn is Frank. Frank has a initiative of 10, and it's his turn. So Frank will go. He'll miss. Then we're going to have a goblin go. Goblin goes. Next goblin goes, Joe, Susan, Frank again. Now we're on round two, turn one. So time traveling debugging, what that allows you to do, because we have a single immutable state tree that's storing all the state in our application, it makes it really easy to, every time that state changes, take the current state, set it aside, and build up a list of those states over time. So if we want to replay that state backwards, we can do that. All the way back. Actually, all the way back when we're fetching stuff from the server, in this case. And then we can replay it forward. So one of the things that's been talked about that you can do, that they're hoping to be able to do with this, and Elm is doing the same thing, actually, is that if you have a bug in your application, you can have your QA person give you the current state of the application along with all the previous state if they're running in debug mode. And then you can actually step through all the steps they took, find the bug, troubleshoot how it got there, and fix it. So it's pretty nice. Over here on the right, we can see the list of actions and the data, what the data was like when that action was performed. We can see we received characters from the server. We received some NPCs. We added a combatant, another combatant, another combatant, another combatant, and then we started calling next turn. And then I showed you the object graph over here of our state tree. So these tools have been really nice to work with. I've enjoyed it a lot. So what time is it? It's 12:36. Got some time for some questions. I can also walk through some code if you want to see something. I can show you what that looks like. Any questions? Right. I have. Actually, so maybe not quite that large. I know some people are building large, but Redux's site, some of the examples they have, one of them, if you scroll all the way down, there's a real world example, and it's a larger application you can look at. One of the things you see on large applications, for instance, is I have a single reducer, right, that handles all of the actions in my application because I have a pretty simple application. But one of the things you'll see is you can actually split out and have multiple reducers that handle just one section of your state tree. So you might have a combatants reducer that only handles the combatants list, or a current turn reducer that only handles the current turn. And how that works is in your container, actually, it will be here, I think, where I create my reducer. Yeah. In your container, one of your containers, what you're going to do is there's a function called combine reducers that takes all of your reducers, combines them into one reducer. Because they're just pure functions, you can actually use functional composition to compose those into one function. So you can split out those reducers and manage things. There is something also being talked about called epics, which handles large applications with lots of reducers, but also how you manage side effects if you absolutely need to do side effects. So. Any other questions? Well, we have a couple more minutes, so I can walk through some code. So you've already seen this. This is my main entry point. This is my container component that starts my app. This is actually part of the Material UI. One of the things it gives you is touch. So you could deploy this on a phone and receive touch events. But here's where I set up my store, apply my middleware, and then when the component mounts, we're going to dispatch getting all the characters, getting all the NPCs. Oh, you know what? What I didn't show was the Phoenix part of this, which you would think I would know better. So one of the things that was nice was wiring this up to Phoenix's channels. So I haven't completely finished this, but one of the things you can see is we have all of the NPCs and characters, combatants, that we have over here. And if I added someone new, let's say a hobgoblin, which apparently did not show up over here, but did over here, which means I have a bug. Oh, because I'm debugging over here. Oops. Now let's add a hob. Okay, I'm in a weird state because I'm trying to debug. But we would see hobgoblin over here and hobgoblin over here. And this is in real time using WebSockets, using the WebSocket layer in Phoenix called Channels. And the other interesting thing is if I close both of these, open a new one, we'll see that everything's still here. And you would think, oh, well, you're persisting that state to the database. I'm actually not. What I am using is basically the same implementation that we did for the stack. I have a game server process running in Elixir that is sitting and waiting. It gets called, it's initiated with a single list. I can get all of the list. I can add something to the list. I can clear the list. And then I'm going to listen for those messages passed to me. So all and clear, and we can add. And this is actually just going to keep a list of, the current state is going to be a list of the combatants. So this is just a process running out there in memory. And the neat thing about that is it is also supervised. What that means is that process could crash, but if that process crashes, my supervisor will be informed that it crashed and it'll just restart it. And one of the things you can also do is you could have it restart with its previous state. So this gives us kind of a highly available feature that's nice. So but does anybody want to see more or any question?
So I guess just to touch on that again, you're basically keeping the state locally then? So on
the server.
On the server or on there?
On the server. Yeah.
Okay, yeah. But it's not in a database though.
It's not a database. It's just a process that has a mailbox, and that mailbox stores that current state. Yes, Chris is giving me weird looks.
Sorry.
Yeah. The process, it's mailbox, it's not storing in its mailbox. The process has its own. So one of the nice things about processes in Elixir and Erlang is that they have their own stack. So for garbage collection, it has its own stack and it's completely isolated from other processes. So if one process crashes, it has no effect on other processes. And when a process dies, it's really easy to garbage collect because it's gone. I'll just take all of the memory that that process had allocated and do away with it. So what you get is really fast GC sweeps. So, so it's storing the characters in its stack. Sorry, not in its mailbox.
I'm assuming that basically since it's storing it in that stack and everything, it's not really in the database, you're going to see a lot better speed performance on it.
Yeah, it's pretty quick. As far as like scalability.
Yeah, like how much, you know, I would think you want to get to the limit where you're not storing too much.
Oh yeah, I think there is a limit on stack size for processes. It's fairly large though. I would probably hesitate if I had gigs and gigs, I would probably actually store that in a database. But I would have processes managing other things like, for instance, when I call next turn, every other turn, maybe I want to roll for random encounters, right? I would have a process that was keeping track of the current turn and says, oh, it's been two turns. I'm going to add to the state this random encounter or something. Did that answer the question or no? Or?
Yeah.
Yeah, you could actually run multiple instances on multiple computers, all connected to the same node. That's one of the things that Erlang gives you, is distribution kind of out of the box. You have one machine, you share a cookie, they connect to each other, and it treats the processes on another machine the same as a process locally, and you can pass messages back and forth. Any other questions?
On the React side of things, you've got state and you've got, say, a bunch of different components on your page. can each of these components have their state managed kind of independently of all the others? Or is it all in a global store?
You have a global state tree. Yeah, and you want that. It makes it really nice to see, A, what's the current state of my application? B, it kind of separates the managing of that state from those components. Now, I have seen people manage some states and components outside of Redux for certain things. If it's like a presentational concern, like is my button toggled or not, you may not, no other component would care about that, right? But anytime you have state that multiple components are going to be subscribing to, you want to put that into Redux. All right. Is that it? Thank you very much.